Okay, hello everybody. So my name is Martin Janiczek. I work at a company called Raynet, and we do like number one CRM system in Czech Republic. So this talk is supposed to be about Smalltalk and what good can we take from it. And now that I think of it, last year I was here talking about Erlang and what can we take from it. So I don't know, do you sense a pattern? I hope I'm not just stealing stuff from languages, but let's call it inspiration. So this is talk about small talk, but it's also a talk about, you know, story about me being an irredeemable procrastinator. So you know, one day I was looking at my projects folder, and I was very sad because it was full of, you know, like half-baked ideas, half-finished projects, and I had I couldn't find any time or will to finish any of that. So, you know, I wrote on Twitter and on Slack and like, how do you guys do it? How do you guys force yourselves to, you know, finish any of this stuff? Surely I'm not the only one. And I think it was Richard Feldman who replied to me on Slack that, you know, he makes social obligation out of it. He submits a talk to conference or to like meetup, and it forces him to finish the project because people expect him to, you know, talk about it. So what do you think I did? I submitted a paper for Elm Europe, and here I am. So, but it probably works differently on different people because, you know, after I submitted talk, fairly nothing happened. So for many months, nothing happened. And then like month before or a bit more than that, I started getting this feeling like I forgot something. I have to do something, I don't know what it is. And I figured it out, I have a talk. So I you know, started doing stuff. So I have something to show you, that's good. but you know, it's a prototype, it's experimentation. It is not, you know, announcement of a new tool with which I am writing all my Elm code now and I am 10 times more, you know, good as you are. I'm not, and the tool, you know, isn't usable, but it's proof of concept, it's experiment. I am just here to share the findings. So, Smalltalk. How many of you have used Smalltalk or read about it or, you know, are curious about it? So it is this language and environment from, I think, 80s. It's written by Alan Kay, who is the father of object-oriented programming. And, you know, it is the object-oriented programming as it should have been. Not, you know, Java, C#, these are not what it is supposed to be like. But Smalltalk is what it's supposed to be like. So it's really a whole lot different world from what we have. And it's different in how they work with, you know, the source code, which is why I am doing this experiment. They have this concept of images. It's more like virtual machine. So you have this virtual machine, you open it, and then there's this environment where you, you know, have all the code for Smalltalk itself, all your code that you write in there, you also run it in there, and at no point do you have, you know, files with your, like we would have Elm modules. It's all just one big binary, and you don't care how it's saved there. But so it doesn't really work with files. It works with, you know, the classes and methods themselves, and you don't know how it's implemented on the inside. So one other thing is that, you know, everything is an object. So things like true and false are objects. and you know, if true, if false, are methods that it listens to. So maybe a Ruby is probably closest to it we have right now. And it has late binding, so you can redefine anything. You can see all the code, you know, like the methods for if true, if false, for the booleans. You can find them there, and you can edit them, save them, and next time that method runs, it's your code. So you can redefine, you know, true to be false, but I expect the image would burst into flames, so I would not do that, but it's possible to do. So the way you work with the source code there is the system browser. I have a low quality GIF of it. You know, on the top you have these four columns, and on the bottom you have the source code. And so on the far left is what they call categories, which are like groups of classes. Then you have classes themselves. Then you have something they call protocols, which are like groups of methods. And then you have the methods themselves. So you kind of drill down this way to the particular method, and then you can edit it. So, you know, how would that map to Elm? Well, we don't have categories. It's a small talk concept. But the closest thing we have to it is probably packages. You know, you have your Elm project, and there are some packages. So on the left, we could have packages. Now, we don't have classes. We are functional programmers. But you know, packages are basically groups of like modules. So we could have modules there as a next step in the hierarchy. And so now the protocols, again, we don't have those. We don't have even anything that would resemble them in the code. But we have, you know, this kind of grouping in documentation. Yeah, so, yeah, sorry, I forgot a slide. We have something like protocols in the documentation, you know, definition, common helpers, chaining maybes. It's like headings under which there are some definitions. So maybe we could use that. I didn't in the prototype, but we could. And then, you know, we don't have methods, but we have you know, definitions, functions, constants, types, type constructors, and so on. So I think it could work something like that. Packages, then modules, then definitions. And when you choose a definition, it shows you the source code for the definition, and you can edit it or whatever. So I have a prototype. It's on GitHub in Janiczek/elm-browser. And so let's see it. So somebody said it's emoji for JavaScript. I think it's emoji for demos. So let's hope it works out. So I don't know if you could see that, but it's an Electron app because I need some, you know, Node.js file system bindings. And okay, so we can create new project or open one. Creating would just do hello world. So let's open something more difficult. You probably can't see that, right? Well, I will zoom in there later. So I will just choose a project. It's just a package that I have that is, it has some dependencies, so there will be more things to show. So right now it does nothing. For a while maybe you could have seen it is compiling, so it runs, you know, elm make and elm package to just get all the dependencies, so it can show you the, like, the whole world, you know, all the code that ever runs in your project. What it's doing now is indexing, so this is kind of slow. I'm doing it in Elm. I'm basically taking all the Elm files and running them through this package, this library, Elm syntax. So it basically parses Elm and gives you all that information, basically almost AST. So that's a great package, but it's kind of slow. I don't know if it's my code or the library code, probably my code. So I will try to... Is it better? Great. So, you know, we have packages, modules, definitions. So, there's my package. If you select a package, it shows you only modules from that package. There are those dependencies and transitive dependencies. So I think HTML depends on virtual DOM. So if I don't choose any packages, it shows me only the modules, and it shows me all the modules. And if I choose package, it filters that. I can also filter, you know, it shows me all the modules, so there are even the unexposed modules, so I can filter that to only, you know, modules I can use. There are like effect modules, port modules. I have nothing because this is a library, and so then there's definitions. So again, some of the things are not exposed, and yeah, when I select a definition, I can see and edit the source code of that. So this is the part of the demo and of the proof of concept that gets into the not implemented territory. So you know, I can do something, but if I open it again, it saved it wrong. So I won't do that, and I will pretend everything is fine. And so this is kind of how it all works. You know, there could be some buttons like new definition or whatever, new package, new dependency, like a lot of stuff could be added. But now for the source code itself, in an earlier version of the prototype, I had you know, custom element with I think it was Ace editor, and for reasons that after Luke's talk I can only describe as stupid, I implemented my own editor, and it's actually a nice story because I'm now going back to the slides, because it you know, it seemed like a huge task, but it really isn't with Elm. And a lot of people seem to think, you know, it's just impossible, but it's not. So this could be one of the points of the talk, that, you know, a task may seem very daunting and outright impossible, but if you try it with Elm, I think you will find that it is very possible. And it is actually kind of easy. So I wouldn't have believed myself to write something like the editor in JavaScript, but in Elm, it kind of just went right. So I think it was implemented in like the core of it was implemented in like 3 hours on my way on the train. So kind of okay. So if you have something you are afraid to do, afraid to program, you know, like the Elm seek, you know, the data structure for the concurrent edits, I would have, you know, not tried that. But if you did, you would have maybe found it's actually quite easy. So try something. Now, it's open sourced. Again, it doesn't do very much. It barely has selection. It doesn't have, you know, copy paste or whatever. It doesn't have colors, syntax highlighting. So it's more of like, you know, retarded Notepad. But it is an editor done in Elm, and we can do more stuff with it. We can add stuff to it. So I actually ate my own duck food from the last year. And last year I talked about the, you know, the update tests. So generate random messages, throw them on update, see what happens. So I actually created some tests. And so these are all, I know those can be read, but those are all, you know, update tests. there are no unit tests and so on, and you wouldn't believe how many bugs it found. You know, so what it told me, like, okay, you have empty editor, you know, add a character, go left, do a backspace or whatever, and you know, it misbehaves. So it found many of these edge cases, and I think it's very it's very good for finding those. So back to the you know, system browser. You know, Smalltalk is very big on TDD, so you know, you can see those green circles. So it shows you, you know, this this class is okay. It passes its test. There are also, like, they call it critics, but it's more like, you know, output from linter and formatter and you know, whatever, like saying this code could be better in this way. And sometimes it says, you know, I can fix this for you, so it fixes it automatically. So I think we could do something like that in Elm 2. We have many tools. We have Elm, you know, analyze. We have Elm format. We have stuff like we have even, you know, the compiler errors. So those could be there. We have Elm verify examples, which I think would be really great for this, kind of like visualization of the of your project, because I think it would I think I would make doc tests for all the functions in my code if I saw something like light up green. You know, it's okay, this passes, whatever, great. I think that will give me a real you know, dopamine rush. So I think there is some space for that. Oh, sorry. So, but it's not all. You know, I've told you the good stuff, but there's bad stuff too. So, what is good is this 10,000 feet overview of your project. So maybe you are coming to a project 3 months after you last touched it. So, you know, what are the types? What do I even do here? Instead of, like, you know, opening files randomly, maybe this is a better way to browse it. The analysis, the summaries. You know, this package is not used anywhere. Why do you still have it in your Elm package JSON? This module has errors. You know, this doc test fails. So I think this could be great. But there's bad stuff too. You know, the Smalltalk world kind of expects you to edit anything you want, because it's your copy of the image and, like, nobody else uses it. But we have Elm stuff folder where the other code lives, you know, the dependencies. And if you change any of that, you know, after that folder gets deleted and created again, your changes are gone. So it doesn't really map well with, you know, Elm. And the fact that you only see one definition, I am kind of, like, ambivalent about it. It might be okay for focusing on function, but I don't really see that as, like, you know, big reason to use this kind of thing. And so what I think makes sense is, you know, making this app, this prototype, not into full-fledged editor, but into something like plugin for Atom or whatever. So, you know, ditch the editor, reuse that somewhere else, but the overview, it would be nice as a plugin to somewhere. So I am a bit sad, in a conclusion, I am a bit sad that not everything maps well and not everything makes sense in Elm world. But, you know, we learned something, we have experience, so we could reuse the good parts in somewhere like Atom or VS Code or wherever. And I am thankful because it was a very great journey. So, yeah, thank you.